Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Zatarain's, a New Orleans tradition since 1889. From our studios in the Southern Food and Beverage Museum in New Orleans, this is Louisiana Eats. I'm Poppy Tooker. It's Tales Time on Louisiana Eats. That's Tales of the Cocktail, an event unlike any other that brings cocktailians from all over the globe to New Orleans in July for some hot action that doesn't just involve the summertime heat. On this week's show, we'll meet Maggie Campbell, the unlikely head distiller at Privateer Rum in Ipswich, Massachusetts. And then we'll travel to Asia with Jesse Falowitz, an American expat who's the moving force behind the resurrection of an ancient Japanese liqueur called Mizu Shochu. For industry success, both Maggie and Jesse must rely on the power of the press. And when it comes to cocktails, there are few greater influencers than Robert Simonson of the New York Times. Robert reports on the cocktail revolution, from the revival of the old-fashioned 25 years ago to what's coming on the horizon next. And when it comes to influence, there are few more influential people in the world of liquor than brand ambassadors. British-born Charlotte Voisey is the reigning queen of ambassadors. Charlotte will give us a peek into the glamorous life of a brand ambassador and tell us just what it takes to become one. All hail the cocktail! It's Tales of the Cocktail time on this week's Louisiana Eats.
My name is Maggie Campbell, and I'm the head distiller at Privateer Rum in Ipswich, Massachusetts.
When you picture a rum distillery, a colonial town in New England is maybe not the first thing you imagine. And when you picture a distiller at that distillery, you may not be imagining someone like the outgoing and eloquent Maggie Campbell. Maggie is a rarity. A female distiller at an old guard rum company. During her visit to Tales of the Cocktail, we were able to grab Maggie for a conversation about what it's like to run a New England distillery with a global following, as well as the role she plays in making the industry more inclusive. Now, I understand that a 2004 trip to Scotland had something to do with why you're distilling today.
Before, I was in the middle of getting my degree in philosophy, which is clearly very highly employable. And I was traveling in Scotland, visiting some historic family sites. And I got stuck in the town of Oban. And I asked a woman on the street. I said, you know, I'm waiting for a ferry to Tobermory. What should I do? And she said, oh, go to the distillery. And I was like, oh, this is a job that people do, and I've seen them do it, and it's real. And so I went back to the States and finished my degree and then immediately enrolled in wine school because back then there weren't craft distilling schools. It was really hard to learn. So I went to wine school to learn fermentation and chemistry and barrel selection, and then it kind of evolved from there.
When did you and Privateer Rum come together?
We came together in 2012. And it was through, I had previously worked for Germain Robin, which is a cognac-inspired distillery in California. And Hubert Germain Robin, the founder, and I became very close when I worked there. And he had met the owner of Privateer, who wanted to go in a different direction. He was all about creating this new style of rum that actually is kind of an old style of rum. And he was very passionate about it being unadulterated and unsweetened and just, you know, pure spirit distilled well with time. And so Hubert called me in his amazing accent of bonjour, Maggie.
Bonjour, Maggie.
Yes, a rum distillery in Boston. And I was, you know, I had studied whiskey and I had studied cognac. I didn't see myself distilling rum. And he made me promise to visit. And within 5 minutes of being there and hearing the owner's vision, Andrew Cabot, he has such a clear vision of what he wants and such a connection to rum historically. I knew the quality. I knew the commitment was there. So we picked up our entire life. My husband's also a distiller, and he distills at Privateer as well. And we sold our home and moved across the country.
Explain to us, who was Andrew Cabot and the history behind this rum?
Yeah. The original Andrew Cabot, six generations ago, was a rum distiller in Essex County in Massachusetts, where we distill today, during the Revolutionary War times. And we actually have the original bill of sale for the distillery. And he was a very successful merchant shipper turned privateer fighting for the U.S. in the Revolution. He was incredibly successful. He ended up with a fleet of 23 ships. And even today, we have a couple stills, and one of our stills, which is our pot still, is named Pilgrim after one of his most famed ships. So Andrew Cabot today was studying his ancestor, whom he was named for, tapped into this history of American manufacturing and craftsmanship. And to him, you know, it's this family legacy. It's not something for fun. It's not a costume he puts on. It's he really sees the timelessness in it and is very committed to long distance.
I've never been to Ipswich. Tell me what it's like.
Ipswich is adorable. It's a little seaside sort of fisherman's village. It has a pretty large Greek and Portuguese population who moved there for fishing. So the local food is incredible. Beautiful cobblestone streets. It's incredibly picturesque. When I moved there, I was like, is this real? And one of the most important things is that we're on this beautiful salt marsh that leads right to the ocean. So we get fresh ocean air every day in our distillery.
Well, I understand that you believe that the salt air that gets into the barrels is something that adds to Privateer rum.
Absolutely. Spirits, a solvent. It absorbs the character of everything it comes in contact with, and that includes the air. The barrels breathe, and right around 18 months, you'll start to get this little mineral finish on the end. And right around 2 years after you sort of take your sip, your mouth will start to really water, and we feel like that's part of the saline effect of that ocean air.
That's fascinating. Now, what is the flavor profile of Privateer Rum's various products?
The flavor profile of Privateer products, I'd say we have a house style, which in general our spirits are dry. We don't resweeten our rum. A big misconception about rum is that it's sweet because it's made from sugar. But by the time you ferment it and distilled it, there's no sugar left. So our rums are very dry, they're highly aromatic, and they're really driven on acidity, so that mouth-watering kind of rich texture. Our silver rum is got sort of an apple blossom, pear, freshly ripe pineapple nose. The amber rum is much more sort of dried cherry, custard, shortbread, brulee. Our Navy Yard, which is 100% molasses, aged in new oak, single cask, is really deep and dark and chewy. And then our Queen Share, every single batch is different, but it's very elegant and very aromatic.
Where does your sugar come from?
We get asked this a lot. It's pretty cool. Most of our sugar comes from Florida and Louisiana. We, in fact, get most of our sugar from closer than a lot of large brands in the Caribbean who have to import their sugar from further away.
There's not a lot of female distillers in the United States, are
there? Right, right. It's interesting. We're here, but there's definitely, it's disproportionately male, and the visibility is really hard. I think it's tricky. I had no idea when I got into distilling that, you know, there were these great women, Rachel Berry in the Scotch industry, and Joyce Spence at Appleton, and Lorena Vasquez at Ron Zacapa. You just don't hear about them. I think we have this story of, you know, the cowboy and the pickup truck, and that's not always who's making your spirits. There's a lot of really amazing women in the U.S. The first female distiller I ever met was Karen from Montagna Rum, and she was really inspiring because it was the first time I saw, hey, that's someone who I identify with doing what I want to do. And it's so important for that visibility for people to see different people doing it so we can attract from a larger pool of talent for tomorrow's distillers. There's definitely some unique situations. I think sometimes it can be harder to be seen as credible. I think being young when I first started was really hard, probably harder than being female. But some of my biggest champions have been men. And most importantly, when I start to think I'm crazy and maybe I'm too sensitive, they'll take me aside and say, did you see what just happened there? That doesn't happen to me. You should know that. Like, you're doing fine. Don't listen to it.
Give me an example.
I definitely was interested in a position, and it was kind of clear that maybe it wasn't the best fit. Maybe they were thinking it was going to be all these different things because I was a woman, and I just wasn't really interested in working with someone who thought maybe they would have a hard time with that. Little comments here or there, you know, when I talk about, hey, we need to include more women, you know, the answer I always hear is, well, we don't want to include people who are unqualified. And it's like, what about them being female means they're unqualified? Like, there's plenty of qualified women. You're just not seeking them out. And I think that's a tricky thing in my industry. I think it's very welcoming to, you know, I think men can see themselves being very comfortable in my industry. So it's going to naturally attract them. And I think that the more we have to actively reach out to say, women, please join us. People of color, please join us. That makes them feel more welcome in a way they might just not naturally feel if they don't naturally see people who they identify with in our community. So we need to actively work to include different people.
How many years have you been coming to Tales of the Cocktail?
This is my third year and my second year speaking, and it's been really great to see Tales continuing to mature. You know, you would think they've been around forever, whatever, every year is different. And this year in particular, there's a level of accomplishment and seriousness as the bar community has matured in the past decade and beyond. And it's cool to see people really sort of take it to that next level, the seriousness and the commitment. It's, you know, it's a party, but it's not just a party.
Maggie Campbell, head distiller at Privateer Rum. When we come back from a short break, we'll hear from journalist and author Robert Simonson, someone the New York Times has called our man in the liquor-soaked trenches. Stay tuned. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats. Edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Rouse's Markets and from Ralph's on the Park, featuring Chef Chip Flanagan's globally influenced New Orleans cuisine overlooking City Park. Lunch, dinner, Sunday brunch, and private events at 900 City Park Avenue in New Orleans Mid-City. Every year at Tales, there's a small faction of people who are neither bartenders nor spirits makers, but they're still major influencers in the industry. Robert Simonson, the cocktail writer for the New York Times, holds a position he virtually invented while witnessing the rebirth of cocktails in the 1990s. Robert brought us back to that moment, a time when classic cocktails like the old fashioned became in fashion in the newly forming world of cocktails. Robert even wrote a book complete with 50 different recipes devoted exclusively to the old fashioned. To begin, Robert described the time this new golden age of cocktails was emerging.
Well, it sort of happened. It was just like a few little rivulets in the 80s and 90s that all met around the year 1999 or 2000, then became this mighty river, and now it's an ocean of cocktails. One of the interesting things about the movement is that it cropped up almost simultaneously and independently in different places like New York and London and Australia. And people were sort of like working in their silos and doing their same things, not realizing that other people were doing them elsewhere. There weren't many books in print about cocktails, good ones anyway. So you had to go to the library or the used bookstores to find things by people like Jerry Thomas and William Schmidt. And you'd study these and you'd look at these recipes and then try to recreate them. And it was hard work. I mean, a lot of these early bartenders were researchers. They had to build their profession back up from scratch because it had been so degraded for so long as a dead-end job where you just kind of slung beers and highballs and things like that. In New York, the main man was a man named Dale DeGroff.
Our hero.
Yes, yes, we all know Dale DeGroff.
Anybody else of that caliber that comes to your mind from the very beginning?
The next one to come along who became, I think, even more influential was Sasha Petrasky, who passed away sadly last year. He was the visionary that created Milk and Honey, which created the modern speakeasy template that was copied so many times in so many cities across the world. And he was just a New Yorker, a guy, an iconoclast who didn't like the bars that he saw in his neighborhood of Greenwich Village, and he wanted a place where people could go and have a quiet, dignified, civilized drink, a good drink, and that's what he created. And that's one of the reasons why I wrote the book now. I spent the last 3 years working on it. I felt the history, even though the movement is young, it's really only, 15, 20, 25 years old, but people have begun to forget.
I'd like to ask you why, out of all the cocktails in the world, you decided that the old-fashioned was the one that was worthy enough to devote an entire book to.
Well, the old-fashioned was one of the cocktails that was, I believe, resurrected and saved by the cocktail renaissance. I remembered the old-fashioned because my mother drank them. I'm from Wisconsin, and a lot of people drink old-fashions there.
But they drink old-fashions there in a very funny way.
They do, and they still do. They drink them with brandy and with the muddled fruit and strange garnishes and soda water and Sprite and all kinds of stuff. The old-fashioned was a drink that really stumped mixologists for the longest time. They knew it was a classic cocktail. They knew they should respect it, but every time they ordered one in a bar, they got this awful soupy, fruity mix that they didn't like. And then people like David Wondrich started cracking the old books and realizing, oh, the drink wasn't always made this way. Once upon a time, it was a very simple drink. Sugar, bitters, bourbon or rye, and just on the rocks. And once they started making it that way, they realized, oh yes, okay, here's a respectable drink. Here's a drink I want to serve in my bars. And also, once they started serving it that way, the young people who had forsworn the old-fashioned as an old fogey drink and nothing that they would ever pick up started liking it too, because this all coincided and dovetailed nicely with the bourbon and rye renaissance. And one could argue that, it is the cocktail. It is the original cocktail. And so I thought, okay, that deserves a book. I didn't think anyone would agree with me, and indeed a lot of people didn't for the longest time. I had the idea for 3 years before somebody said, okay, we'll let you write that book.
Would you give me the evolution of how that drink changed from the earliest recipes that you could find and the version from the 1950s?
Mm-hmm.
Take us down that path.
So in the early 1800s, the first half of the 19th century, it was just called the whiskey cocktail. I mean, the full name of the drink is the old-fashioned whiskey cocktail, and that's why we call it an old-fashioned, which is really just an adjective. We're just like saying an adjective. May I have an adjective, please? It's like Jeopardy. No, wait. Well, who asked for adjectives? I don't know. I forget which game show.
A man walks into a bar and says, fix me an adjective.
Yes. So, right. Here's an old-fashioned. You can put your noun after that. So a whiskey cocktail was whiskey, bitters, sugar, water. And it was originally served up, meaning it wasn't on the rocks. And probably room temperature sometimes. And it was like a morning drink. It was what they called an eye-opener, which was a very wide category back then, that like men would wake up and they'd go to the bar before they went to work. And so you'd get a whiskey cocktail. Very simple drink. So then when you get to the 1870s, bartenders get more toys to play with. Liqueurs come from Europe, things like chartreuse and maraschino liqueur. Vermouth arrives. That creates a very big splash in the cocktail world. So they started creating what they thought were improved whiskey cocktails. Whiskey cocktails with a little bit of this and a little bit of that. And this, of course, gets the old schools back up. And so they start asking for an old-fashioned whiskey cocktail. Give it to me the old-fashioned way. And so then you get this kind of like retro movement where they're getting the simple whiskey cocktail back, only it's not the same anymore. It's not made with sugar anymore. It's made with simple syrup. It's not served up. It's served on the rocks because it's the end of the 19th century. It's the Gilded Age. We have fabulous saloons and people are more leisurely in their drinking, so they can just sip that old fashioned rather than knocking it back. So you had like two competing old fashions for a while. You had the classic old fashioned, and then you had these souped up ones. Early 20th century, you started to see introduction of fruit, but the fruit is usually on top as a garnish. And then, of course, we get prohibition and everything goes black, everything goes dark, and everyone forgets everything. When we get on the other end of that tunnel, the old-fashioned is a drink that everyone remembers, but now it's being made differently. Now the muddled fruit is coming in. They muddle the fruit, and they pour in the whiskey. It's still on the rocks. There may be maybe a little soda water on top. It's kind of, I don't know, an adulterated version of the original cocktail. Nobody really knows why that happened. They may have started adding fruit in the prohibition to mask the taste of bad liquor. They may have started adding fruit because, strangely enough, after prohibition, old-fashioned was thought of as a woman's drink. They liked it because it was sweet. And this is when women could start to drink in public because of prohibition. They could now go to bars and nobody would think badly of them. So that version dominated, the muddled fruit version, really until the dawn of the 21st century when the young, brave new mixologists discovered the old versions and brought that back. But of course, the muddled version is the version that you see most often in regular bars still.
I would like to hear from you, Robert, about where you believe New Orleans is placed in the geography of cocktails.
New Orleans is a special case because it is a city that never forgot the cocktail and it never stopped embracing the cocktail. Very few places on the planet have invented as many classic cocktails as New Orleans. But I think by the time the cocktail revolution came around, New Orleans was a bit set in its ways. They had been drinking the same things the same way for a very long time, and those things were very good, but they were not moving forward. Katrina was a huge influencer in the cocktail movement because what happened is it displaced everybody. And a lot of the important people, they went up to Chicago, they went to Seattle, they went to New York, and they saw what was going on there in terms of bars and cocktails. And when they came back, and most of them did come back, they came back with ideas. And so that's when Cure opens. And the Cure people open many subsequent bars. And now New Orleans has the best of both worlds. You have the old bars that have always been doing it. They were classic cocktails and are still doing them the way they always did. So you got the tradition. And you've also got innovation. You've got newer bars that are doing the fresh ideas. So I feel that's its role right now.
How did you become a drinks writer?
Well, when I first came down to Tales of the Cocktail, my first year was 2006. I was writing about wine. And I met Anne Tunneman, then Anne Rogers, by accident in New York at a pop-up Illy coffee cafe that she was helping to promote. And she just, I wrote a story about the pop-up cafe, and she said, come down to New Orleans, I do this little cocktail thing. And I had never been to New Orleans, and I thought, good excuse to go to New Orleans, finally. And I came down here and realized there was this world of spirits producers, cocktail bartenders, cocktail bar owners, and that they were all very passionate, and they were all very excited about the prospects of their industry, and they're also very colorful. And wine people are many things, but they're not particularly colorful. And I thought, this is interesting. Perhaps I could write about this. And I decided to shift my focus because I saw at that moment that a new profession had been invented, and that was the cocktail writer, which hadn't existed. There were just a few examples, people like David Wondrich, who were writing steadily about cocktails and spirits. But I saw that the newspapers and magazines were interested in this new movement, and they needed people to write about it who knew what they were talking about. So I was, you know, right place at the right time.
Is there something incredibly memorable that you've learned here?
The first tales I went to, one of the first seminars I went to was with a guy named Ted Bro. And this was when absinthe was still illegal and you couldn't get any. And he had absinthe. And we sat there and we drank absinthe and had an absinthe trip. And he talked about it. And I just thought, how is this possible? It's like, how did he get this stuff? Shouldn't the police be coming? And so that was an eye-opener. That was particularly memorable. But I've had many experiences like that since.
Robert, thank you so much for taking time out of your busy schedule to sit down and have this leisurely conversation.
It's my pleasure.
It. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.
New York Times cocktail writer, Robert Simonson.
Hi, my name is Charlotte Voisey, and I'm the ambassador for William Grant & Sons.
After meeting an outside observer of the cocktail industry, we now turn to an industry insider. As a brand ambassador, Charlotte Voisey represents that subtle but necessary link between makers and purveyors that gets your favorite brand behind the bar at the end of the day. Charlotte took time out of her busy schedule at Tales to tell us about the globe-trotting life of a brand ambassador.
So a brand ambassador is essentially a spokesperson for a brand. At William Grant & Sons, we have quite a unique, defined approach to how we hire and motivate our brand ambassadors. Two things we look for above all is someone who truly embodies the brand they're working on. So somebody who dresses the part, who exudes the same characteristics and style of the brand. If the brand were somehow to come alive, this person would fit into that world. And the second thing we prize is personality. Again, it's a people business. We look for charismatic, fun, engaging personalities because that truly does engage and with people and sort of connect the dots and get messages across. So those are the two things we prize. But essentially, the brand ambassador is there to educate and entertain and ultimately make people fall in love with their brand. That's the end goal, lofty goal.
What is a day in the life of a brand ambassador like, Charlotte?
I think a typical day has to include a flight of some sort. We're always packing and unpacking and boarding aeroplanes. And then it would probably involve some kind of educational training session, whether that's for bartenders or members of the public, cocktail enthusiasts, if you will. And then there's probably throwing a party in there somewhere, being the life and soul of a party, which could go into the wee hours. Which is often followed by another early morning and a flight. So the typical day of an ambassador would be highly energetic, very long, but lots of fun.
It sounds like a lot of fun, but it's also a lot of hard work because there's so much travel involved.
Mm-hmm.
And at the same time, if someone has been a bartender, they may feel a little isolated and left out as a brand ambassador.
Yeah, that's a great point. Bartenders obviously work in teams. As a brand ambassador, while you're constantly with people, your sort of mission, your travel can be quite lonely, especially when things go wrong. It's fine when everything goes to plan and you arrive when you should, but when the flight delays kick in or the hotel reservation was messed up, and you have to sort of solve these problems by yourself, and there's no one around to lean on or vent to, that can be quite challenging, which means another great quality for a brand ambassador is to sort of be a self-starter and sort of get up and go and entrepreneurial, sort of you can solve problems and get it done yourself, because you need to rely on those skills.
Well, you have had your finger on the pulse of the cocktail industry for a decade now. What do you think is coming next?
The last 10 years, yeah, it's almost been an explosion of everything that we wanted to see happen. Fresh juice, great spirits. We're drinking now cocktails of a quality that I don't think has ever been enjoyed before. The last sort of golden age in the 1800s didn't have the technology and the techniques to extract flavor from ingredients like we have now. It didn't have the internet to share ideas. It certainly didn't have the ease of global trading that we do now to enjoy ingredients from all over the world. So I think we're truly in the best era. So what will come next? Hopefully the wider understanding that cocktails are truly a part of food and beverage. It's not a trend. We might start seeing cocktail programs in sports arenas and large concert venues, that type of thing, to really hit the mainstream. In terms of innovation, it feels like we've thought of everything.
It does.
It does. But there are still a few people out there who I refer to as having truly original thought, who every year come up with sort of new things that you don't see coming. So it's an exciting time.
Now, we've already established that you've been coming to Tales of the Cocktail for a decade.
Mm-hmm.
When you come back every year, what is the thing you look forward to the most?
I know this event so well. It's a progression. The week's a progression. I love arriving early here at the Monteleone. By now, everyone that works here also knows me because I've been coming here so long. And then it's the Spirited Awards that I look forward to on Saturday night. I feel like it's everyone's chance to sort of dress up and feel special, like a treat.
What about these spirited dinners? What about dinners where you go and you have cocktails paired with food?
Yeah,
I'm sure you must have a diplomatic answer for that.
Of course I do. I'm an ambassador. Spirited dinners are interesting. It gives us an opportunity to show what cocktails can do with food. I don't think any of us truly believe, and I may be speaking out of turn, that every dinner should be paired with cocktails. And the spirited dinners here at Tales are wonderful. They're often four or five more courses. That's clearly not the norm. It's a special occasion. But it does push the envelope, I think, when people are considering flavors and how to combine culinary techniques into cocktails. Just from my spirited dinners and watching others work with chefs, you immediately learn new tricks, new ideas, new angles, because chefs think in different way to bartenders. So that alone has provided great education, I think, for us behind the scenes. And for the guest, it's funny because certainly in the early days, perhaps not so much now, you'd start off with the dinner and they'd all enjoy a nice welcome cocktail, the first course, it's all fun, but slowly they'd be reaching for that red wine glass. You could see them sort of get in a little, surely there'll be wine as well, right? Because it's such a comfort, it's what we know. So I always used to sort of thank people for their spirit of adventure to come try the cocktails.
If you looked back over the last 10 years and you could pick out one single memory, what would that be?
I think it's when we threw the party at the World War II Museum. We had the world's freshest Ramos gin fizz. We had lemon and lime trees. We had a sugarcane press. We had a case of Hendrix that we flew over from Scotland, so it was the freshest possible. And we had some chickens laying eggs, and we had a cow that we milked for the cream. And it was the most spectacular moment. The planning for that party was fun. The cow was, I think, $200. And it's the single best investment because people to this day still stop me in the street and comment about that cow. and how it was such a wonderful moment. And what a lot of people don't know about that night is as soon as the clock struck 12, I had to go to the airport and get on a private jet, the only time in my life I've done it, because the next day I was filming Iron Chef America in New York. I went there, landed, filmed all day, and got on the next flight back to Tails on Friday morning, and I promise you no one even noticed I was gone. It was so magical. It was so crazy. It was a pinch me moment.
Charlotte Voisey, brand ambassador with William Grant & Sons. What is a Pousse Café? Stay tuned, and we'll answer that question when we come right back. Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen, Zatarain's, and from French Market Coffee. French Market Coffee's premium blended beans are locally roasted in small batches, creating a coffee that can only be called New Orleans Bold. Here's this week's culinary quiz question, brought to you with support from Popeye's Louisiana Culinary Institute. What is a Pousse Café? A Pousse Café is an elaborate drink that's a throwback to the 19th century, something that hasn't quite made its way back into modern cocktail culture. It consists of 10 or 12 layers of liqueur, each a different color, stacked carefully, one on top of the other, creating a magical rainbow effect. Originally, it even had its own stemmed glass. Again, something you're not likely to see anytime soon. The layered effect is created when the bartender gently pours each liqueur over the back of a spoon. The flavors vary, but often include grenadine, maraschino liqueur, creme de menthe, creme de violette, yellow chartreuse, and brandy. The important thing a bartender has to know is the viscosity of each, because that's how you get the floating trick to occur. If you grew up in the New Orleans of the 60s and 70s, it's a good guess you remember Nick's original Big Train Bar on Tulane Avenue. Nick's had actually been in existence since 1918, first as a neighborhood grocery that began selling liquor after Prohibition. Proprietor Nick Castro Giovanni was famous for his Pousse Café and claimed to hold the world's record for most layers, having once poured 32 different liqueurs into the pony glasses he preferred. Nick's rebuilt after Hurricane Betsy in 1965, but didn't make it back after Katrina. Good news, though. Nick's Big Train Bar purportedly is coming back to Tulane Avenue. So get ready to belly up to the bar and order a Pousse Café. I'm Poppy Tooker, and a Pousse Café makes for good Louisiana drinks.
Big train, make that whistle sigh. Big train, make that whistle cry. Big train, don't you tell me a lie. Big train, why'd you ever say goodbye?
If you've spent much time at Tales of the Cocktail, you've bumped shoulders, most likely in the packed lobby of the Monteleone Hotel, with a plethora of people from every continent on Earth.
After meeting Jesse Falowitz, I learned that there are some Americans who have become expats for the cause. American-born Jesse Falowitz is the founder of all things Mizu Shochu, the ancient Japanese liqueur that, thanks to Jesse and his Japanese counterparts, is entering a modern market.
So shochu is a traditional Japanese spirit that's been around for nearly 500 years. And the idea behind it is that it's single distilled, and that's a very important part of the story. A single distillation really captures the natural essence of the raw ingredients. The second thing is that it uses a very special ingredient called koji. Koji is a microbe that's used in the fermentation to make a lot of things in Japan. You make soy sauce from it. You make miso paste from it. You make sake from it as well. Specifically for shochu, it's used in the fermentation process, and it kind of replaces the malting process that you would normally have in a grain spirit. It's breaking down the starches into sugars. But not only is it doing the physical kind of chemistry of the fermentation process, it's also adding a lot of flavor and aromatics to it as well. And then the third thing I would say that shochu is really all about is this bit of rustic charm that it has. In the same way that a bourbon or a moonshine kind of has, you know, kind of southern charm to it, in Japan, shochu is really originated in the southern part, the southern island of Kyushu. Down there in the south, southern part of Japan, it's very rural, kind of very countryside, very kind of agrarian area of Japan, and it's really kind of has this beautiful rustic charm to it.
I don't remember ever having been in an American sushi bar, restaurant, etc., where they were offering me shochu. What's up with that?
So there's a really good reason behind that. And again, kind of talking about the southern Japanese charm that shochu has and the fact that it traces its roots really to that southern island of Kyushu in Japan, it's a little bit off the beaten path. It's a part of Japan where you have, again, these are small mom-and-pop distilleries. A lot of these families that produce shochu don't get off that island too much. But it's just, the business for shochu has been really, really good over the last 15 years. And as a result of that, there hasn't really been a strong desire for these distilleries to export their products. The demand domestically in Japan has been so good that they're really kind of focused on keeping their products small batch, you know, craft quality, very artisanal, and they don't want to compromise that by just overproducing and shipping out to other places. Now, there's a second part of this as well, which is everybody does know sake here in the United States. That's yes. Typically what you're going to drink when you go to a Japanese restaurant.
Right.
So Japanese food really became popular here in the U.S. in the 90s, let's say. You know, late 80s, 90s, you start to see it. During that time, sake was the trend in Japan. If you want to say the 70s, 80s, early 90s, sake was really kind of booming in Japan. So when all those restaurant owners and chefs came over to the United States and they were starting their own restaurants, or when Americans went over to Japan to kind of get some exposure as to what Japanese food was all about, in those days, everybody was drinking sake. So that's the drinking culture that we brought back to America. And shochu was kind of overlooked at the time because it was still a deep south thing in Japan.
How is it drunk originally, and how do you drink it today?
You really have two things happening in Japan when it comes to the cocktail scene, the craft cocktail scene. You have the old guard, and then you also have the new guard. The old guard really emulated Western cocktails of the 1920s and 1930s, those kind of hotel bars where they're very buttoned up in their tuxedo shirts and their white jackets and their bow ties. And those types of bars are really just going to be doing classic cocktails. That's pretty straightforward. And that's been a big thing in Japan for a long time. The younger generation of Japanese bartenders are guys that have come to Tales of the Cocktail, guys that have worked in, you know, New York and San Francisco and London and have been exposed to more of a modern craft cocktail culture. These are people that have been exposed to a lot of different ingredients and are much more creative and experimental with what they're doing. When they come back to Japan to open their own bars or new bars, they kind of do a little bit of a fusion of East meets West, and you have this amazing combination of like Western ingredients, but then they have great pride in sourcing local ingredients as well. So now they're starting to use a lot of these kind of higher proof shochus, a lot of other Japanese ingredients as well, and putting those into their cocktails.
Tell me about your master distiller. Who is he, and how long has he been doing that?
So his name is Hirofumi Okoba. We call him, in Japanese, you'll say like Okoba-san. You add san to the end, and that's sort of a respectful kind of way of saying somebody's name. So Okoba-san grew up very close to the distillery. He actually grew up on a farm. His mother still owns the farm and still works on the farm. She's got to be in her 90s. She's out there. It's absolutely amazing to see, you know, this kind of culture, farming culture that's down south there. So they still source our barley, some of our barley and some of our rice from that farm. And he just has a very close relationship with all the local farmers in the region. So one of his mottos, or one of the mottos of the distillery, it's 100% locally farmed ingredients. And that's a very big point for him, obviously, because he grew up as a farmer and he grew up in that region. So it's very important to him to have locally farmed ingredients.
Well, I just can't wait to see what this is like. How would you suggest we taste this?
I would suggest we try it neat first, and then add a little bit of ice as well to open it up. So on the nose, you're going to get a lot of really tropical notes. There's some cantaloupe, there's some banana, even like a banana bread kind of thing going on there.
Yeah, there's something like toasty and lovely in the glass.
Smell, the aroma is a little bit like a sake, but it's a little bit fruity, and there's some really nice things going on there. There's also a little bit of grassiness as well coming from the barley, but a lot of those kind of melon and banana notes are coming from that black koji rice.
Okay, and now for the taste. Oh, it's delicious. Looks like vodka, not like vodka.
Right.
That's pretty amazing.
Yeah, it's almost like if you somehow married a young whiskey with a sake with maybe, you know, vodka. But vodka is so neutral, whereas in this is not neutral at all. There's a lot of depth and a lot of character to it.
Jesse, how many years have you been coming to Tales of the Cocktail?
This is my third year, actually.
What's the most memorable experience you've ever had at Tales?
The most memorable experience I've ever had at Tales was probably a late night at Aaron Rose, at the Aaron Rose, where somebody was doing a really good job on the jukebox, and every bartender in the house was singing along to every single song. This was going on for about 5 or 6 hours. It was absolutely unbelievable. The energy in the room, everybody was obviously had a few drinks in them, but the energy was amazing. It went on and on and on. And as somebody who lived in Asia for a long time, I love karaoke. So this was kind of like a full bar karaoke sing-along. And we didn't leave the bar. I didn't leave the bar until 9:30 the next morning. And it was just that much fun. I just didn't want to go home.
That's
we were just
a rare
having a great
experience,
time.
Isn't yeah. it? It's rare you go someplace for 9:30 in the morning. It's still the night before inside.
Yeah, I mean, the sun was well up at that point in time. And I think I was sitting in the windowsill and just enjoying the morning air and still having a few drinks. It was great.
Thank you so much for introducing me to the world of shochu. I'm in. Thank you, Jesse.
Thank you so much, Poppy. This is awesome.
Jesse Falowitz, founder of Mizu Shochu. That's it for this week's edition of Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Join us next week when we take a virtual trip into the Appalachians with food historian Ronnie Lundy.
Pork was not a centerpiece necessarily on the table. It was a seasoning or a condiment or almost a side dish. And it was used to season a number of vegetables and foods that gave us good nutritional value.
Have you missed an episode of Louisiana Eats? Hear today's show or catch up on previous editions anytime online at itsneworleans.com, where you can also subscribe to the podcast and take us with you wherever you go. If you love Louisiana Eats, let others know and help like-minded Louisiana food lovers find our show by leaving a review on iTunes. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen, Zatarain's, French Market Coffee, and Rouse's Markets.
Additional support for Louisiana Eats is provided by the Shreveport-Bossier Convention and Tourist Bureau and the Palace Cafe, home of crab meat cheesecake and white chocolate bread pudding in the historic Whirline Music Building on Canal Street. Original theme music by Johnny Sketch and the Dirty Notes. Big thanks to producers Joe Schreiner, Sarah Holtz, and Reggie Morris. Come visit us anytime in our Louisiana Eats studios at the Southern Food and Beverage Museum. Don't forget to find our recipes and see what we're up to at poppytooker.com. You can check us out on Instagram and Facebook as well. I'm Poppy Tooker. Louisiana Eats is a production of Poppy Tooker Broadcasting.